welcome to the first night of our first ever virtual revival with Dr. Susie Shellenberger. To join us and would like to view the service, you can go on our website and there you can see archived services and you will be able to enjoy last evening's service as well. Susie Shellenberger has been with us several times in ministry over the years, and we are glad to have her a part of this virtual revival. She is a Nazarene evangelist. She has been in ministry for several years, and we are excited to have her with us. Let me just say that tomorrow our virtual revival continues, and not only will it be live streamed, but all of our services tomorrow will also be in person right here in the sanctuary of Fortville Nazarene Church. And that will be at 9 a.m., 11 a.m., and 6 p.m. And we would invite you to come and be with us or join us online. If you would like to help support our revival efforts financially, you can do that online. You can go to our website at fortvillenazarene.org and you can click on the tab Renew52/revival, and there you can give your offering. Thank you for your financial support. Well, I'm excited for this second night of revival, and so let's have a word of prayer and ask God to meet with us in a special way this evening. Father, thank you for your love and your grace and your goodness. Thank you for all that you mean to us, and thank you for the opportunity of revival. And Lord, whoever is tuning in tonight, I pray that you would meet them right at the point of their need. Thank you for our evangelist. Thank you, Father, for their message of music and their message from the Word of God. And I pray that you would help us to open up our hearts to you. Speak to us, I pray. Thank you again for this opportunity. We pray in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Again, our worship leader, Justin Wells, is going to come and introduce our music guest for this evening. Let's pray that God will meet with us in a special way as we enjoy this revival service together.
Hi, church family. Thank you again for joining us this evening for our revival service. I wanted to take just a minute this evening and introduce you to tonight's artist that will be leading us in worship. This young lady is from Nashville, Tennessee. She went to Trevecca and majored in music business there, worked actually in the country music industry for several years, but now is a registered itinerant song evangelist in the Church of Nazarene, one of my favorite singers, absolutely wonderful, and you're going to love her. Her name is Lindsay Huggins. We're glad to have her with us for our revival this evening.
Hello and welcome to worship. It is good to be with you virtually, and I invite you to sing with me from wherever you are as we prepare our hearts for what the Lord would say to us.
Excellent word.
I'm thankful that we can place our hope in Jesus. 1 Corinthians says that he is the only foundation, the only thing that we can build upon that will ever truly matter. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. I'm so thankful that we can depend on God's love to always show up and to keep pursuing and to keep meeting us, whatever our situations look like. He'd be the last one you'd expect to see walking up those church house steps, hard as a stone and jailhouse mean, Saturday night still on his breath. But we all saw a miracle that day, like watching Lazarus come out of the grave. Thank you. There have been times I've been broken, times I broke myself. There have been times I've been empty, and I wouldn't ask for help. Looking back across the years, I see there's one who's been my refuge and my peace. I've had bright days of knowing, dark nights of doubt, seasons filled with victory, and times I went without. But if I've learned a thing about this life, through every up and down, He's by my side. He's the God of joy and sorrow.
Legos began in the workshop of a Danish carpenter by the name of Kirk Christensen. He began making wooden toys in 1932, and 2 years later named his company Lego. In 1947, the company expanded into a new technology and began producing plastic toys. And in 1949, they produced an early version of their interlocking bricks, and the rest is history. Here's what makes Legos so successful. Regardless of age or ability, anyone can pick up Lego pieces and let their imagination run wild. The entire Lego brand was built on a simple foundation. One small plastic brick, 31.8 millimeters long by 15 millimeters wide, with 8 studs in a row of 4. Well, there are now more than 37,000 different types of pieces, from minifigures to tubes and accessories such as wheels and swords, and more than 900 million building combinations are possible with just 6 bricks of the same color. Okay, maybe you're wondering, so what? What do Legos have to do with me and with God? Well, it's all about the connections. You see, what made Lego different than the original blocks that Christensen started to build was their ability to connect. And because of the round pegs that connected them, what they could create seemed almost limitless. Let's look at what's been titled some of the greatest Lego creations. This is an impressive Batman, isn't it? Woo! And hey, this is a 20-foot tall Lego house. Wow. And what an amazing R2-D2. Here's a detailed representation of the Taj Mahal. I've seen the Taj Mahal, and that's really pretty close to the real thing. Here's a life-size giraffe. And can you believe this realistic Volvo XC90? And one more, here's an amazing airplane. Lego's pieces were made to be connected. And we too were created for connection. And the ultimate connection we were designed for is intimacy with our Creator. That's the most powerful connection there is. Well, how do we do that? How can we develop intimacy with God by ramping up our connection? Let's look at some people from the Bible who were intimately connected with God and see how they did it. We can begin in Genesis, actually the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve definitely experienced intimacy with God, didn't they? They were one with Him. They had nothing to hide and no one to hide from until that moment, they compromised their connection. And that damaged the intimacy they had with Creator God. Let's go to Genesis 3. We find Adam and Eve being tempted by Satan to do the one thing that they were told not to do. The command is actually found in Genesis 2, 15 to 17. Let's grab a quick look. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." Well, the damaged connection began with temptation. Hey, we're all tempted. Jesus was tempted by Satan. Temptation isn't disobedience. Disobedience is disobedience. There was just one thing they couldn't do. They couldn't eat the fruit from one tree. That was it. They could climb the tree. They could build a tree house in the tree. They could cut down the tree. They could do anything except eat the fruit from the tree. But you know what happened? Fruit salad for lunch. Let's look at the first line in Genesis 3, immediately after they deliberately disobeyed their Creator. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Before they deliberately disobeyed, they had no shame. Immediately after their disobedience, they're filled with shame. And with that shame came a break in the connection. Now, when you're playing with Legos, every now and then you discover that they just won't connect. And when you look closer, you discover that someone has used the Lego for a Play-Doh cookie cutter. And because of that, the connections just don't connect. They're gummed up with stuff that's not supposed to be there. Well, Adam and Eve's connection with God had become gummed up was something that wasn't supposed to be there. Sin. Sin always messes up our relationship with God. When we wonder why we're not as close to God as we used to be, it could be that sin is blocking our intimacy with Him, and we need to seek His forgiveness and repent. Now, most of you have asked for His forgiveness, and He has forgiven you. But repentance is different. Repentance is walking away from a sinful lifestyle. Thankfully, God is in the restoration business. When our connection with Him is damaged, He wants to repair it so we can have the intimacy with Him that He desires us to have. Okay, but how? How do we, finite men and women, connect like a tightly connected Lego piece with an intimate God who created the universe. How can we become intimate with him? Let's get back to Adam and Eve. Before their connection became blocked with sin, they developed intimacy by spending loads of time with God every single day. Okay, Susie, that was easy for Adam and Eve. I mean, it's different for me. I have a job. I have a family. I have responsibilities or studies. I have things to do. I don't get to walk around in a garden all day chatting with God. Hey, Adam and Eve weren't simply wandering around with nothing to do. They were probably a lot busier than any of us. They had to name all the animals. Now, you know how we ladies like our furniture? Over there. No. Over here. No. Let's put it here. No. And our wall hangings? More to the left. Well, no, that's not right. Let's go more to the right. Move it up a bit. No. Okay, translate that to animal naming. Adam says, Eve, you name the next one. This little guy here. And Eve says, he will be a Frankenfurchitzitter. No. He's going to be a Kutzinghur. No. Let's call him a Hoopensee-Dider. And Adam's all, okay, a Hoopensee-Dider it is. But just like moving furniture, Eve isn't satisfied. Nah, she says, let's just call it a mouse. Then they go to the next animal. And Eve says, this will be a Bugensee-Kepper. And Adam says, that's too complicated. And Eve's a Bugensee-Kepter. I feel good about it. And Adam persists, babe, this is taking too long. We're not even to the flying category yet. We're just going to call it a baboon. Scientists estimate there are 8.7 million animal species. So just naming the animals would have kept Adam and Eve busier than we are. And the earth has 391,000 species of plants. But they also had plants to identify, and there are 391,000 of those. On top of that, they had to learn the basics of life, how to swim, how to do somersaults, skip, you know, the essential things. Hey, they were busy. And they were probably a lot busier than we are, but they made spending time with God a priority. And we can too. I imagine Adam and Eve made God a part of everything they did throughout their day. They were in constant communication with him, talking with him about everything, seeking his direction. They enjoyed his fellowship. They enjoyed loving him. And this connection created intimacy. They were truly connected to the creator of the universe. And just as God connected intimately with Adam and Eve, he also wants to have that same kind of intimacy with us. So connection equals intimacy. So by now you know connection and intimacy are going hand in hand. Someone else from the Bible who experienced great intimacy with God was David, the king of Israel. And even though he had his struggles and he wasn't perfect, we see his strong connection in Psalm 63. Let's look at it. Oh God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you. My soul thirsts for you. My whole body longs for you in this parched and weary land where there is no water. Another component of intimacy with him is to desire him. If you desire intimacy with God, you have to want to connect with him. And David begins by acknowledging the relationship. Oh God, you are my God. This wasn't somebody else's God with whom David was seeking intimacy. It was David's God. David had already connected with God in the sense that he had a relationship with him. But David desired genuine intimacy in his relationship with Jehovah. You can have a relationship with someone and not be connected to him. I know some marriages like that. The husband and wife have settled into simply being roommates. Well, technically, they're husband and wife, they're married, They've never divorced or even separated, and though they live in the same house, they're no longer connected. Or maybe you know some parents who are estranged from their children, or the other way around. There's still a relationship, but no connection. There are a lot of people who have a relationship with God. They've accepted forgiveness for their sins. They've experienced His grace, but it hasn't gone any deeper than that. And like the marriage without connection, there won't be real joy in a relationship with God without an intimate connection with Him. David is craving to have a deeper relationship with God. He wrote, "My whole body longs for you." He truly desired God. And David actively sought God. "Oh God, you are my God. I earnestly search for you." When we actively seek Him with our whole heart, we will find Him. Seek Him. Again and again and over again, the Bible reminds us that when we seek God, we will find Him. God promises us in Proverbs 8:17, "I love all who love me. Those who search will surely find me." And let's look at His promise in Lamentations 3:25 about seeking Him. "Oh, the Lord is good to those whose hope is in Him, to the one who seeks Him." When we actively seek Him with our whole heart, we will find Him. Now, we can long to connect with someone, but never move beyond that desire to an actual connection. Charlie Brown's relationship with the little red-headed girl proves that. But God promises that if we seek Him with all our heart, we will find Him. Well, how else does David develop intimacy with his Creator? Let's keep reading. "Your unfailing love is better than life itself. Oh, how I praise you! I will praise you as long as I live, lifting up my hands to you in prayer." Communicate with Him. We see that David is genuinely communicating with his Creator, and it connects and creates this dynamic intimacy and connection. So, how are you communicating with God? Adam and Eve spent time with Him, and they talked with Him. David is praising Him. Yes, he's using verbal conversation, but he's also using music. He's singing. He's worshiping. And this is key. Talk with God. Sing to God. Praise God. Worship God. Communicate with Him. But intimacy with God involves even more. So let's continue with Psalm 63. "I lie awake thinking of you, meditating on you through the night." If you're going to connect with God, you'll need to listen to God. And listen also means to meditate. What is meditate really all about? Meditate means thinking about something deeply. I often think deeply about tacos, but that's beside the point. When the people of Israel were going into the promised land that God was going to give Joshua, He gave them direction for government. And this was a part of those directions. So let's take a look. "Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do." That's Joshua 1:8. Prayer is us talking to God. The Bible is God talking to us. Susie, don't give me that. The Bible is boring. I don't understand it. Okay, well, get one you can understand. Get one that's packed with cool graphics and explanations and scripture helps. Get a Bible you can identify with. There are all kinds of Bibles on the market today. Let's take a look at some of the Bibles on the market right now. Here we see the children's Bible. And here's the action Bible. Take a look at the teen Bible. And then we get specific with teen girls Bible. And even more specific with the teen guys Bible. Oh, and here's the college Bible. And here's a Bible for couples. Here's a busy mom's Bible. And here's just a mother's Bible. Maybe she's not as busy as the busy mom. She's just a mother. Here's the Bible for dads. And here's a sportsman's Bible. Here's a waterproof Bible. I love this. I love the definition that the marketing department gives the waterproof Bible. Listen to this. The durability of the waterproof Bible gives you the freedom to take God's word with you anywhere. Boating, traveling, camping, with worry-free confidence that your Bible will withstand the test of time. We also have the journaling Bible. And then there's the military Bible. But we also have the military Bible in cameo. We have a metal Bible, a Bible with giant print, then a small print Bible, and even a thin line Bible, so you can kind of hide it and no one will know you're carrying it around. We have an extra wide Bible, a single column Bible, and a double column Bible. Hey, why not just get a blank Bible so you can write your own? I'm just kidding. But get a Bible that you like the feel of, the smell of, and the size. And then once you have one that you love, read it. Start with the Gospels. Read the story of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then read the book of Acts. That's the story of the church. You know, it's hard for me to understand people who say they're Christians but have never read the story of Christ. Seems like you're taking a pretty big chance, gambling your eternity on someone you don't know a lot about. And then finally, David writes this, "I cling to you. Your strong right hand holds me securely." An intimate connection with God means you trust Him. Do you trust God? I mean, really, really trust Him? Do you trust Him with your today and your tomorrows? Do you trust Him with your checking account, your relationships, your dreams, your life? Here's what Jesus tells us about trust. Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, and trust also in me. When we trust God, we draw closer to Him. And when we begin to trust Him with our family, our finances, and our future, we begin to lean on Him. And you have to be close in order to lean. As you trust in God, you lean more into His presence, and you can't trust from a distance. Maybe you need to connect with God for the first time in your life. You can do that right now and become a part of His family. But perhaps you're already in His family. But just like the Lego that's been gummed up with Play-Doh, your connection isn't so great, and it's affected your intimacy with Him. Oh, you desire a good connection. And you can have that. In fact, that's what God desires too. Maybe you've been wondering why you don't have a good connection with God. Well, let's ask Him right now. And here's the truth. If you ask Him, He'll tell you. Because when you seek Him, you will find Him. He has promised that. God desires intimacy with you. If you want intimacy with Him, the ultimate connection, let's pray about it. Let's pray about it right now. Bring to my mind, dear Jesus, anything that's standing between us and making my connection with you gummed up. Dear Jesus, what's blocking my intimacy with you? Help me think of it right now. Hey, I'm going to play a music video that I'm sure you're familiar with. It's called Draw Me Close to You. And as this song plays, would you continue to pray about the ultimate connection with Jesus Christ that you want to have? And then after that video, I'm going to come right back. So stay put.
Close to you, never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. You are my desire. Else will do, 'cause nothing else can take your place. To feel the warmth of your embrace, help me find a way, bring me back to you.
Just as the song says, God really does want us to draw near to Him. Draw me close to you, O Lord. I have one more music video that I want to show you, and it's an old song. As the deer longs for water, as the deer pants for water, that's how I desire you, God. Go ahead and continue to pray during this last music video. And may you have an ultimate connection with genuine intimacy in Jesus Christ.
is there.